I'd like to say good morning. My name is Pam Venuti and I'll be your moderator this morning. And I'd like to welcome you all to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any organization. The school is dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh our Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. The school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. This Ithaca branch was established in 1979. At this time, I'd like to introduce you to the Dean of the Ithaca branch, Dr. Robert White, and our host, Dr. Gregory Prestis. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Heavenly Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. And the name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua, the Messiah. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lord's many and there are God's many. But we now know that every Lord must have a name and every God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord or God, Elohim is a divine title. That means Elohim is the title that the Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it's an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew, the Greek, nor the Latin languages contain any letters that would produce the sound that's made by the letter J. The letter J didn't come into the English language until some 1400 years after the death of the Messiah. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in this pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular shape or form. We have drawn the cloud all around the edges of the chart. Everything on the chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is a Word or Son, a super incorporeal being that is having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form could only be seen in divine visions, and understood in divine revelations. Later on, the self same spirit manifests in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Joshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of his name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also, in the school, we teach by a divine pattern of the universe. It's called the divine pattern because it's Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In the school, we show proof that everything is the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and how that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Now also in the school, we have 10 primary constitutional aims, and they are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, both modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10 is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is feed, and our slogan is to speak truth. Our slogan is to speak the truth. At this time, we'll have a prayer to dedicate today's lecture, and that will be given by Dr. Judith Turner. Then we will have the scripture, which will be read by Dr. Peg Trevison. And our scripture is Matthew, the 5th chapter. Please, Judith.
Yahshua, we bow our hearts, we bow our minds, we bow our being to your everlasting love and salvation. We know that we couldn't get anywhere without you. In Yahshua's precious name, let us all say,
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Matthew, the 5th chapter. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain. And when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see Yahweh Elohim. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of Yahweh Elohim. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under the foot of men. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Think not that I'm come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. You heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not kill, and whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hellfire. Therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there rememberest that thy brother hath aught against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar, and go thy way. First be reconciled to thy brethren, and then come and offer the gift. Agree with thine adversary quickly, whilst thou art in the way with him, lest at any time the adversary deliver thee to the judge, and the judge deliver thee to the officer, and thou be cast into prison. Verily I say unto thee, thou shalt by no means come out thence till thou hast paid the uttermost farthing. You have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, that whosoever looked on a woman to lust after her has committed adultery with her already in his heart. And if thy eye be offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that the whole body should be cast into hell. And if thy right hand offend thee, cut it off and cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that the whole body should be cast into hell. It has been said, whoever shall put away his wife, let him give her a writing of divorcement. But I say unto you that whosoever shall put away his wife, saving for the cause of fornication, cause her to commit adultery, and whosoever shall marry her that is divorced committeth adultery. Again, you have heard that it has been said by them of old time, thou shalt not forswear thyself, but shall perform unto Yahweh thine oaths. But I say unto you, swear not at all, neither by heaven, for it is Yahweh's throne, nor by the earth, for it is his footstool, neither by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Neither shalt thou swear by thy head, because thou canst not make one hair white or black. But let your communication be yea, yea, nay, nay, for whatsoever is more than these cometh of evil. Ye have heard that it has been said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you that you resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if any man will sue thee at the law and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain. Give to him that asketh of thee, and from him that would borrow of thee, turn not away. You have heard that it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, and do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that they may be the children of your Father, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love them which love you, what reward have you? Do not even the publicans the same? And if you salute your brethren only, what do you more than others? Do not even the publicans so? Be therefore perfect, even as your Father, which is in heaven, is perfect. That was Matthew, the fifth chapter.
Thank you, Dr. Trevison, and also thank you, Dr. Turner. We will be having a three-speaker format today, and for our first speaker, I'd like to call on Dr. Frank DeMasi.
Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
Well, we're facing another year now. And we all have to realize how blessed we are that we understand and recognize Yahweh's purpose. And we find comfort and consolement in that understanding, where the world doesn't have that. Now, you looked at it, like I watched last night, and everybody was hugging and kissing like it was a world that's just in complete glee and joy. And in the morning, they're going to be hung over and recognize the reality of what's going on in this world. Let's start at the scripture and see what I can do with it.
Matthew 5:1. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was sat, his disciples came unto him.
All right, Peg, I'm going to interrupt you. I'm not trying to be rude.
No, fine.
So, you know, this scripture, to me, before coming into class, what we recognized it as was they called it the Beatitudes. And it was just Jesus on the hill blessing or saying this and saying that, had no understanding and no ideas about anything of Yahweh's purpose or what's going on, old covenant, new covenant, had no understanding whatsoever. But by grace and mercy, he's called us to make us to this gospel and made our eyes open to see and understand his purpose and what's going on. I didn't know that everything that Yahshua was doing was a fulfillment. I didn't understand that. But the world doesn't understand it. All the world that Greg, can you get to the covenant chart? Yeah, see, all the world did was everything that was on the left, everything that was carnal, everything that was physical, mm-hmm. was temporal. All those things, that's all they did is they thought it ended at the cross. They put it on the other side of the cross, took out old and made it new. And people are doing the same physical things. And they're caught up in physical manifestations and aren't understanding the spiritual principles behind them. But by grace and mercy, Yahshua has opened our eyes and allowed us to see the manifestations and learn from them and understand the spiritual principle it's representing. Mm-hmm. And that's what these beatitudes are. These are all things of describing a nature that is going to be put in you. It's not you doing it. It's not you deciding one day that, hey, you know what? I'm not going to act this way anymore. I'm not going to feel this way anymore. Because if you made your own decision, it would last for a week. It would last for a year. And then you would fall back to your old ways because you're depending on yourself. This is a gospel of grace and mercy. And it's the understanding that you, all you are is a participant in it. You recognize and realize what has occurred to you. You realize that all the things that you were, that you held precious and high before you came into this class and this gospel are now rearranged. Now no more are you pursuant of your own self, of your own glory, or your own riches. And it's not, you didn't just decide that. You couldn't decide it. Like you can't decide how you fall in love. It just happens. It's all in Yahweh's purpose. It's all been set up. Oh, I'm getting carried away. All right, get past the Beatitudes and let's get to 17.
Verse 17.
That's where I'm at.
Think not that I'm come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
Yeah, see, and they're not understanding what's being said. They're not recognizing or realizing, you know, we go all the way back to Exodus and the Ten Commandments that, you know, there was a marriage that was Israel agreeing to do what Yahweh asked them to do. But Yahweh knew and set up in his purpose that Israel couldn't do it. And, you know, we should just start right there at the Ten Commandments. What was the penalty of sin in them times? The penalty of sin was death.
Yep.
If you broke, there was 613 total ordinances and laws. 10 laws and 603 ordinances. Mm-hmm. And they couldn't keep them. Adam and Eve couldn't keep one. How are you going to keep 613? In Catholicism, they've got like 200 or 2,000 something different tenets and obligations that they want you to try and perform it. And you fail miserably. And it's set up that way, but we didn't know. We were pulled out of that darkness. Or we would still be there today blaming ourselves because we can't keep our soul so-called clean because we keep either swearing or thinking something stupid or whatever. Whatever laws, it's a nature. You had a different nature and you didn't even know. And it's one of the most powerful things that I've come to understand in this class is when Mitch used to say to us, when you don't know, you don't know. Boy, you really don't know. And that's just how it was. We didn't even know we didn't know. We were so consumed in our own selves and our own ways and our own thoughts that we thought, you know, it was a world according to us. We were the center of our attention. That's not how this gospel is set up. Once you realize the blessing that's been bestowed upon you and that you see and understand the truth by the cogent witnesses of the law and the prophets, pointing out those death, the burial, the resurrection, the glorification, all those principles are all being shown to you. You're changed. You can't go back. You can't rebuke them. You can't say, well, yeah, that's pretty, but I like my way better. No, that's not how it is. It changes your nature. It changes the way you feel. It changes the way you live. You have become a new, that's how you're born again. You become a new person. I get a kick out, you know, I'm a masochist in ways, I guess. I watch these preacher boys on TV, and they got now a Jewish Jesus on TV. You know, it's just, you know, it's just what that mystery of iniquity does, he just blends. He blends one lie to another lie to another lie, where it becomes, honestly, it's scary. It's comical. I mean, but yet people fall for these things. There was another article, a TV show about a huge church that was originated in Australia called Hillsong. Here, this church is creating billions of dollars of monies, and yet, you know, every time that they were doing, they were creating music that was attracting people, and they had professional musicians and all this pretty music and all, and they had these two special guys that were their top preachers, and every time they would get up and preach, they would tell these people, hey, you know, for instance, you know, when you go and you want to get a coffee every morning, make your coffee at home. And the money that you were going to spend to buy coffee, give to this church so we can spread this word. And they're showing these preachers on TV, and these guys are wearing $3,500 shoes, $1,000 suits, you know, all these high class things that they're wearing, and yet they want people to give up money so they can, you know, they can't even get a cup of coffee. It just shows the hypocrisy. And all these things, by mercy and grace, like some of these people, they've been exposed. There's been a big to-do about it. But that's just monetary things. We're not even talking, that's just physical. What about the spirituality that they're trying to pretend that they understand, that they're laying down to these people? There's just so much deceit and misery out there. But yet, by grace and mercy, we have been comforted. We have been called. It was beautiful that we had a really nice class last night. We're talking about, you know, in Romans, the 8th chapter, how, you know, we've been called to be conformed to his nature. That's what this is about. By the foolishness of preaching this gospel, a soul, a dead soul, not, you're alive, you're breathing, but spiritually, you're dead as a doornail because you have no understanding of your creator. But by mercy and grace, you hearing this and him having you in his mind in the beginning, before anything was, that there was a certain time in his purpose that your eyes are going to be opened and your heart is going to be changed, and boom, you're hearing this gospel, and all of a sudden a light bulb clicks and a hunger is created, and you want to learn, and you want to hear, and all of a sudden, through time and through grace and through mercy, your nature has changed. Your desires, your priorities have all been changed. And it's not a stressful thing. It's not a hardship. It's a joy. It's something that you're not doing it for your own glory. You're just trying to make other people see the beautiful, powerful, unexplainable things of our Creator, of Yahshua the Messiah, and how beautiful this gospel can be. And how Romans 1:19 and 20 can come alive right before your eyes. It can come alive. The spiritual principles can come alive by physical manifestations. And you can see and understand the total intent that your creator wanted you to see. And that's by grace and mercy. And you're there, and you're there with, you could be, I just went through a funeral with 100 something people in a church, and I felt like a stranger in a strange land, because these people were all, of course, saying that, you know, my relative is in heaven playing pinochle with my grandfather. You know, it's just how it is. And they had no spiritual understanding. And you're in that room and you're feeling, how can you be the only one that sees and understands and not being deceived? They tell you when to sit. They tell you when to stand. They tell you when to kneel. They tell you what to say. You're like, they're like cattle.
Right.
But like mercy and grace, you're not that way. Are you better? I'm not no better. Only thing I was in tears. It was so humbling to realize and see that I'm a stranger in a strange land.
Mm-hmm.
And that's only by mercy and grace. That's not me. Okay, I'm getting carried away. Let's go back to the scripture. go to 18, please, Peck.
Mm-hmm. 18. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
Yeah, see, that's what we didn't understand. Everything that, why did, that was his purpose. He came in to die. He came in to live a law that no one else could do, to put it out of the way. When you fulfill something, you fulfilled it, you brought it into reality. We didn't know anything about that before coming into this class. We were still stuck in that old covenant, the physical way of worship. It was temporary. It was physical. It didn't leave them perfect pertaining to their conscience.
Mm-hmm.
You know, again, my infamous 15-minute walk to try and serve mass. I couldn't make a 15-minute walk without swearing or doing something stupid. And then they, you know, I took it serious. Well, you got to take that cracker. And they told you if you take the cracker and you got a sin on your soul, a mortal sin, you're going to hell.
Mm-hmm.
And being a, you know, maybe a dumb, maybe a intimidated kid, I was scared. Right. I was scared. And I blamed myself. I never even once thought to blame the church. It wasn't in my ideas. I was so intimidated, so enveloped in their nonsense. I never questioned it. It was just a sign of authority. All I did was try and be obedient, and I couldn't. That old covenant, that's why it was set up. It was a physical way of worship to make us see and understand something, but there were spiritual principles involved. And now he had to come in and live that and fulfill it and nail it to the cross. You see it right there in this chart right here. It's nailed to the cross, but yet what has the world done? The world has not recognized it. They just brought it over to the other side of the cross. Most of them I never realized, and I was one. I always had a gold cross I would wear. I have a necklaces that I would wear, you know, medals of Saint this or Saint that. I had no spiritual understanding. What it really reveals is you're stuck at the cross. Mm-hmm. This is a new covenant. We don't have the chart where the stony heart and the... Do we have that chart?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there it is. And this is how we were on that left. That's how we were before we came into class. Mm-hmm. Dr. Kinley said we were dead on arrival. We had no spiritual understanding. I didn't know how many years... For me, myself, and I'm younger than some, I would get on my knees and say, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. And never once even dropped into my mind that, hey, what is his name? I just thought Lord God and Jesus. And that's how it was. We were dead in our sins. We didn't know any better. And just by mercy and grace, all of a sudden our hearts being converted. Look at this. In Ezekiel and Jeremiah, how he's writing his nature in us. He's changing our ways. The stone is being broken away. And now all the way on the right, look at, there's a heart of flesh. Our nature has changed. We recognize and realize the gift that's been bestowed upon us. We recognize not only that, is that we have it's a love. It's not an obligation. It's a love to spread this gospel to whoever will hear it. It's not anything that we're looking for. Hey, look at I'm a big preacher boy kind of thing. It's not about it at all.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, read on. Let's go to 19.
19, whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven.
Yeah, keep going. I want one more.
For I say unto you that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven.
Before coming to class, I didn't know what the kingdom of heaven was. When I heard kingdom of heaven, I'm in my mind before class, I'm thinking of a castle and a big wall in the sky somewhere, and I'm going to be maybe somehow get in there. I didn't know anything about what the heck a kingdom was. The same thing with the scribes and Pharisees. They had no idea. They didn't have a heart in them. It was set up that way. But they were the religious leaders of the day. The same that's going on then is going on now. You can use so many beautiful different manifestations to show that principle. Like the with the sheep and the shepherd. The shepherd is falling asleep. The wolf is among us. The same thing. I mean, this is what's going on in this world, but this is Yahweh's purpose. It's set up that way. It's not anything it's there for us to see and to appreciate if we're called to realize and appreciate the things that we know and rely on the power in us that Yahshua has put. And that's our only hope of glory is him in us. It's not us doing anything about it. We didn't decide one day, hey, you know what? Every Saturday night for the rest of my life, as long as we're having class, that's where I know I'm going to be. That wasn't in my mind before coming to class. Before coming to class, every Saturday night, I had a bottle in my hand. I was all doing all kinds of things that I wasn't really proud of, but I didn't know no better. That was my God back then. That was my... that's what I pursued. I wanted the things of the flesh. I wanted to go out and wanted to party and have a good time and raise havoc and be happy. Be happy with what? I was miserable. I was miserable, but I didn't know it. And yet by mercy and grace, you come to this class and you come to this school and this gospel. And all of a sudden, some black guy from Ohio says he had a vision and a revelation from the creator himself. And I'm thinking, oh yeah, okay, this is, I remember when my sister first told me about this and I'm saying, yeah, that's kind of who we, you know, and then I would just somehow, I would talk again and all of a sudden something would stick and I would talk again and something would stick. And it's set up that way that things, each of us are going to have a time where our Pentecost is going to occur. And all of a sudden, our nature and our ways are going to be changed. And it wasn't us that did it. Okay, read on. The kingdom. Yeah, I'm going to finish the kingdom. So that kingdom, that's Yahshua in you. That's the kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
But we didn't know that. We didn't know anything about that. Again, you know, we have to realize that there's only one truth out there. There's only truth. It's not truth, plural. There's just truth, and there's a lot. And we were inundated in lies. We were inundated in men's vain imaginations and products of men's vain imagination. But by mercy and grace, he has pulled us out of that. He has made us, he's given us the ability to discern and expose that mystery of iniquity. Okay, read on.
Verse 21, you have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not kill, and whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment.
See, now what's going on in what he's doing, he's trying to make them understand spiritual principles by using the physical manifestations and showing how the nature that is in Yahshua is going to behave and how a carnal nature is going to behave. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's what's going on in this chapter. He's he's showing us spiritual principles, and people are looking at it and saying, well, geez, how is this, you know, it's falling on them, but they don't have the heart in them to understand it and incorporate it in their very nature. Okay, mm-hmm. Read on.
22. But I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment, and whosoever shall say to his brother Raca shall be in danger of the council, but whosoever shall say thou fool shall be in danger of hellfire.
Well, therefore, get to where your enemy turn your cheek and all that, and now I'm get down. Now how much time left? See, all he's explaining a nature. He's explaining his nature. He's explaining how, if you have Yahshua in you, you know, your pride, your reputation isn't forefront. What's forefront is a preaching and the love of the truth and this gospel. That's what the nature is going to be converted to. But before that, you know, you have a nature of your own self, of your own pride, your own desires. And that's the difference. That's a conversion. That's how the circumcision, that's how in Jeremiah and Ezekiel, that he's going to take that stony heart out of you and he's going to give you a heart of flesh. And he's going to cause you to walk in his ways. And that's what's going on in this purpose right now. Here we are facing another year. You know, we never thought, at one time, we thought we'd never see the year 2000. Now we're at 2023. You know, all we can do is hold fast, prove all things, hold fast to what's true, love this gospel, love one another. Mm-hmm. And just realize that we have a creator that's in complete and total control of this purpose. And if it means anything about our flesh, you want to take our flesh away, you want to do whatever, he's conquered death, hell, and the grave for us. We're not afraid of dying. We're not afraid of, some of us are looking forward to it, the miseries that we have in this flesh. Mm-hmm. But all we can do is stand fast and be of good courage and good faith and know and see that Yahweh is control of his purpose, and it's only through Yahshua the Messiah that it's our only hope of glory. I hope I inspired somebody, and mm-hmm. I'm gonna give up the floor. I'm gonna give all honor and glory to Yahshua. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Dr. DeMasi. And for our next speaker, I'd like to introduce the Dean of the Ithaca Branch School, Dr. Robert White.
Good morning. Can everyone hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, good. Enjoyed the remarks of the first speaker very much. And I just want to bring out a few things from the scripture lesson in hopes to better people's understanding. And hope I can succeed at that. Hope the boss is with me today. Mm-hmm. Let's go back to the scripture lesson, please, and pick up the 17th and 18th verses once more.
Matthew 5:17. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
Now, I'd like a dictionary definition of the word fulfilled, please. Does anyone mm-hmm. have it?
I can get it on my phone.
I can Google it. Let's see.
Now, the things that I'm going to discuss, most everybody that is present understands already. But we have to keep in mind, this class is going on YouTube. It's posted. And I looked the other day, and in the last class that we had, there was 130 people that had watched this class. So we don't know who they are.
People.
That's a lot of people for a little small class like Ithaca. But apparently, it's catching on.
Right.
We're out there, and we have something to say, and people and appreciate it. So everybody's understanding is not the same. And Mitchell used to say, having formerly been in the Navy, that you don't have a convoy unless you go as unless you're moving as at the same speed as the slowest ship.
Right.
Otherwise, you just scattered across the ocean. And that's what we're trying to do, is we're trying to keep a convoy. So I would like the definition of fulfill if you have it.
I've got bring to completion or reality, achieve or realize something desired, promised, or predicted. To carry out as required, pledged, or expected.
Now, first definition was to bring into a realized reality. So I'd like to go back and reread these last two verses and substitute the word fulfill with bring into reality.
Okay. Matthew 5:17, think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to bring into reality. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be brought into reality.
Now, we search the scriptures as we've been instructed to do. And the founder showed us how to go into the law and the prophets. And he said, when you go back to the law and the prophets, you find the spirit there. So we go back and we look at the manifestations that are being practiced back on under the old covenant and extract the principles from those manifestations. And that brings it into reality. That brings us home. That accomplishes something in each and every one of us. I'll give you an example of that, and then we're going to go back to drop down to 21.
Verse 21. You have heard that it was said of them of old time, thou shalt not kill, and whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment.
Now, where's Yahshua getting that from?
The law.
He's getting that right from Mount Sinai.
Right.
Now, if he is who he says he is, where is he? Physically so. Go back to the first verse.
He's on the mount. And seeing the multitude, he went up into a mountain. And when he was set, his disciples came unto him.
Read.
And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying,
so he's speaking down to a group of people who are Jews or Israelites.
In a mount.
From a mountain.
Right.
Now, if he's fulfilling or bringing into reality what was back there in the law, and he is who he says he is, it's got to be the same one speaking it down.
Right.
Now, reread 21. And then read 22.
21. Ye have heard that it was said of them of old time, thou shalt not kill, and whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say unto you.
Wait a minute. Hold on. But I say unto you.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raka.
Raka means empty headed, stupid.
Oh.
Go ahead.
Shall be in danger of the council, but whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hellfire.
Now, hellfire is the lake of fire.
Right.
He's putting things on them that they're not capable of yet.
Right. Because the
spirit has been poured out.
Right.
They will be capable after they receive the Holy Spirit by the Holy Spirit in them, which is not happening at this point. But he's got to come in and he's got to accomplish or fulfill that old covenant.
Mm-hmm.
Now drop down to 27 and 28.
27. Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you. That whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after he hath committed adultery with her already in his heart.
So you see the depth that he's bringing in?
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's not surface. It's not physical. He's bringing in the spiritual reality of what's going on back there. The depth of it. That's what the founder just struggled with us to be just always conscious of the omnipresence of Yahweh. And you can't do that on your own. You need divine help. I need divine help.
Mm-hmm.
So if he's fulfilling, let's just get a witness for the sake of people that have not come to this teaching for very long. Let's go back to Exodus, the 19th chapter, please. And pick it up at 3.
Exodus 19:3.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses went up unto Yahweh, and Elohim called unto him out of the mountain, saying,
okay, thus shalt thou. Now, where are we? If we go to the Moses chart, please, Greg.
Yeah, 1 second.
Yep.
According to the scripture, they're in the desert of Sinai in the wilderness.
Yes. So okay. Here we have pictorially illustrated on the left side of this chart.
Mm-hmm.
We have Mount Sinai in Arabia.
Mm-hmm.
3,500 years ago, and Moses goes all the way up to the top of the mountain. You can see them up on the top of the mountain there, having a panoramic vision of Elohim,
mm-hmm.
90 before the birth of Yahshua. And drop down, go to the 20th chapter of Exodus and pick it up at 1.
And Yahweh Elohim spake all these words, saying, I am Yahweh.
Now, here's Yahweh Elohim doing the speaking from Mount Sinai in Arabia.
Mm-hmm.
3,500 years ago, or circa 1,500 years before Yahshua.
Mm-hmm.
And he's reread 1, and I don't want you to drop down to probably 13 through 17.
And Elohim spake all these words, saying, then drop down to 13, thou shalt not kill,
mm-hmm.
thou shalt not commit adultery.
Did we just read that in the 5th chapter of Matthew?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So he is who he says he is.
Mm-hmm.
In order for it to be fulfilled or accomplished, it's got to be Yahweh Elohim in that man speaking down from a mountain to accomplish what was set up or fulfill it.
Mm-hmm.
And he's going one step further. He's bringing it into reality. and he's putting things on them that they're not capable of. But I say unto you, in other words, he's giving them the bowels of it.
Mm-hmm.
This is what the intention was. This is what it truly means. Okay, keep reading. And that's it.
Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery. Verse 15, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is thy neighbor's. So, and all the people.
So here we have him fulfilling or accomplishing or bringing into reality what was set up. Mm-hmm. He's bringing it to an end. He's closing out that old covenant and getting ready to usher in a new covenant. Mm-hmm. But it had to be instituted before it could be fulfilled. Mm-hmm. You can't fulfill something that hasn't been implemented.
Right.
It has to have an initiation or a starting point.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can fulfill it. You don't just dematerialize down here in Florida and wind up in Syracuse.
Right.
You have to plan the trip. Mm-hmm. And then you have to, after you plan the trip, then you have to accomplish the trip and make the drive or the air of travel or however you, whatever mode of travel you decide to use in your plan. But it has a beginning and it has an ending. Now, let's go to the 12th chapter of Exodus, please. Right up at 1.
Exodus 12 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh Elohim spoke unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month, thou shalt take to them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for a house.
Mm-hmm.
And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb. For the lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door post of the houses wherein they shall eat it. And they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Eat not of it raw nor sodden at all with water, but roast with fire his head and his legs, and with the protuance thereof. And ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning you shall burn with fire. Thus shall ye eat it, with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it in haste. It is Yahweh's Passover.
Okay, so now who's declaring and setting up this Passover?
First Yahweh Elohim.
And Yahweh spoke unto the children of Israel, unto Aaron, Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt. So Yahweh himself is establishing this, and these are all the divine specs that he's putting on it. And we can take each one of these, and we have over and over and over again, and run these principles all the way down through the book, law, prophets, fulfillment, and then bring it into reality.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he's taught us to do. That's what the Holy Spirit has put in us to accomplish, to do. Let's go over to Ezekiel 45:21, and then the 26th chapter of Matthew. I'm just trying to lay down a couple of quick examples of bringing things into reality or the fulfillment. That's what his job was. That's what his whole ministry was all about.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever he was doing, he was doing in fulfillment of that which was already set up. And we have to go back to find out in the law and in the prophets what exactly he initiated and what he set up, what he confirmed in the prophets, and how he came in and accomplished it. That was his job. so he could shut out and move away that old covenant and make a brand new covenant. He's got to close one out before he can start another one. Okay, Ezekiel, please.
45:21. Mm-hmm. In the first month, in the 14th day of the month, you shall have the Passover.
Now, here we are in the prophets. Do you have a time on that?
I don't.
Okay. Anybody have it?
Chronology,
thank you. Approximate. A lot of people have it in the first chapter of
14. Yeah. 1450 before the birth of the Messiah.
Okay, thank you, Uncle Rick. Appreciate it. So here we are, almost 1500 years after the setup of the Passover, and they're still keeping the Passover. Now, Yahshua's got to come in and accomplish that and fulfill it. So let's go to the 26th chapter of Matthew, pick it up at the first verse.
Matthew 26:1, and it came to pass, when Yahshua had finished all these sayings, he said unto his disciples, you know that after 2 days is the feast of the Passover, and the Son of Man is betrayed to be crucified. Then assembled together the chief priests and the scribes and the elders of the people unto the palace of the high priest, who was called
Caiaphas. Okay, and I'm going to have you drop down because I want to edit this.
Now the first day of the feast of the unleavened bread, the disciples came to Yahshua, saying unto him, where wilt thou that we prepare for thee to eat the Passover? And he said, go into the city to such a man and say unto him, the master saith, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at thy house with my disciples. And the disciples did as Yahshua had appointed them, and they made ready the Passover.
So he's already got a place prepared to have the last Passover memorial feast that was established way back in the 12th chapter of Exodus.
Mm-hmm.
So he's coming in to accomplish that. And he does so. And let's drop down to 26 and read down.
20.
Please.
Matthew 26:26. Mm-hmm. And as they were eating, Yahshua took bread and blessed it and brake it and gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body.
Now hold it right there. Did his cousin John point him out as the Lamb of Yahweh?
Yes.
That's John 1:29. You can verify that on your own. I don't have the time to get into it. Okay. And here he is. He's breaking this Passover. He's bringing this into reality. They didn't understand, nor could this be accomplished when it was instituted.
Mm-hmm.
It had to run its course until it came down to Yahshua being in the flesh, accomplishing what was implemented. So here he is bringing it into reality. And as they were eating, Yahshua took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them and said, take, eat, this is my body. Not that bread. He's pointing to his own self.
Right.
Okay, read.
And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them saying, drink ye all of it. For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many.
This is my blood. This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many, for the remission of sins. That's the purpose. Go ahead. 29.
But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.
So, I mean, we could go on further with this. You can go over to Revelations and find out that he stands at the door and knock. Mm-hmm. And if you open the door, he'll come in and he'll sup with you.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever hear of food for thought?
Mm-hmm.
It's not a physical eating.
Mm-hmm.
So all these physical manifestations back there in the law and in the prophets were not the reality. They were a type, T-Y-P-E. They were a shadow. They were an example of heavenly things or spiritual. Mm-hmm. And we're going back to the law and the prophets to extract these principles. I want to go to Leviticus, the 23rd chapter, please.
Mm.
I'll tell you what verse in a second here. Let me go back there. 23:15-20, I guess. We'll stop there.
Leviticus 23:15. And you shall count unto you from the morrow after the Sabbath, from the day that you brought the sheaf of the wave offering, 7 Sabbaths shall be complete.
Now, this is important. This is after the Passover.
Mm-hmm.
This chapter is dealing with all the feast days mm-hmm. that were required under the old covenant between Yahweh and Israel. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this I'm going to interrupt you. I'm going to because this is important things that are being brought out here, and he's telling them to count 7 Sabbaths plus a day.
Mm-hmm.
So that'd be 49 days plus one,
mm-hmm.
which would be how many days?
50.
Very simple. It's not hard. It's not rocket science. He does it all in simplicity. He has to, because I'm a simple man with a simple mind. I'd never see it. All right, go ahead and read.
16, even unto the morrow after the 7th Sabbath shall ye number 50 days.
Now he comes right out and says 50 days.
Mm-hmm.
50. Let that stick in your mind. So 50 days.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
And you shall offer a new meat offering unto Yahweh.
Now you're going to offer a new one unto Yahweh. Mm-hmm. A new meat offering. New. Now this is back in the old, but he's establishing that there's going to be something new. Go ahead.
17, you shall bring out of your habitations 2 wave loaves of 2 tenths deals. They shall be of fine flour. They shall be baked with leaven. They are the first fruits unto Yahweh.
Now, wait a second here. The first fruits, the harvest. It started out as a seed. Now the wheat is fully grown, so it's going to be harvested.
Mm-hmm.
That's showing forth. What did they do with the seed?
Good.
It was in a dormant state. They buried it.
Mm-hmm.
And then what happened?
Resurrects.
It resurrects from the earth.
Mm-hmm.
So it's showing forth the principles of a death, a burial, and a resurrection. Now they're going to have a new meat offering. And this one, they're going to use leaven. They're going to bake that bread with leaven. Onto the Passover memorial, could they use leaven?
No.
So now we're setting up a new one that's going to use leaven. And they're the first fruits unto Yahweh. 18, please.
And you shall offer with the bread 7 lambs without blemish of the first year, and 1 young bullock, and 2 rams. They shall be for a burnt offering unto Yahweh, with their meat offering and their drink offerings, even an offering made by fire of sweet savor unto Yahweh. Then you shall sacrifice 1 kid of the goats for a sin offering and 2 lambs of the first year for a sacrifice of peace offerings. And the priest shall wave them with the bread of the first fruits for a wave offering before Yahweh with the 2 lambs. They shall be holy to Yahweh for the priest.
Now, anyone that is familiar with the 16th chapter of Leviticus, which is the Day of Atonement, you got the same menu here. You got the same thing going on here.
Mm-hmm.
It's identical. So I'm running out of time fast here. Acts, the 2nd chapter.
Okay.
I want 1 Corinthians 15 and 20. First.
1 Corinthians 15 and 20, you said?
Correct.
Yeah, 1 Corinthians 15 and 20. But now is Yahshua risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept.
So it looks like the Apostle Paul was familiar with this being back in the law. Mm. Would you agree?
Mm-hmm.
So what leaven is the reality? Where is Yahshua risen now?
In hearts and minds and minds.
In our understanding.
Mm-hmm.
That's raising a dead, sick, sin soul and bringing it into reality.
Mm-hmm.
Showing the spiritual reality of the scriptures. Now Acts 2 and 1, please.
Acts 2, verse 1.
Mm-hmm.
And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost.
Oh, see, and now here's the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. It says they were all filled. And what was the date? When did this take place?
June 6th.
June 6th, yeah. But 50 days after his crucifixion.
Right.
Pentecost, mm-hmm. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit, mm-hmm. Which is what we just read back in Leviticus in type, not the reality, but now here's the reality of it taking place. 7 years later, now this is happening with the Jews. Acts 10:34, let's bring in the Gentiles.
Acts 10:34, it says, then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth, I perceive that Yahweh is no respecter of persons, but in every nation, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him.
Now, the word. How does faith come?
By hearing.
So the gospel is being preached and the recipient is hearing it, one who was caused to hear it and recognize it and believe it,
mm-hmm.
by virtually having the Holy Spirit in their tabernacle, in their vessel, which causes us to understand these spiritual principles. Otherwise, we'd be a lost ball at high school, as Mitch used to say. Keep reading in 10 Acts, please.
Okay, 36, the word of Yahweh sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Yahshua the Messiah, he is master of all. That word, I say, ye know, which was published throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism of John preached, how Yahweh anointed Yahshua the Messiah with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for Yahweh was with him. And we all witnessed of all things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hung on a tree.
They crucified him, read.
Mm-hmm. Him Yahweh raised up the third day and showed him openly.
Now, what's Peter doing down at Cornelius' house? He's preaching the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. They slew and hung on a tree. They nailed him to a cross. They killed him. They crucified him.
Mm-hmm.
He was publicly executed. He's dead. And it says, Elohim raised the third day and showed him openly. Keep reading.
Not to all the people, but unto witnesses chosen before Yahweh, even to us who did eat and drink with him after he rose from the dead.
Well, this gospel's not for everybody. Everybody's not going to receive it. And it's not meant to. It's by design whom Yahweh chooses to reveal himself to. Go ahead, hurry.
42, and he commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify that it is he which was ordained of Yahweh to be the judge of quick and dead. To him give all the prophets witness that through his name, whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins.
Mm-hmm.
While Peter yet spoke these words, the Holy Spirit fell on all them which heard the word.
All them that heard. All them that heard. Mm-hmm. And it's through Peter as he spoke. So Peter, being a recipient of the Holy Spirit, we can go back to Acts, the second chapter. I didn't want to take the time to do it, but we find his name in there. Peter and John, after they received the Holy Spirit, they started preaching the gospel.
Right.
And they got beat up for it.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just trying to edit this to give time to another speaker. Keep reading.
45, verse 45. And they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Spirit.
So now we've got the Gentiles involved. So there's now neither Jew nor Gentile, neither bond nor free. He's made us all one. We're a unity. We're the body of the Messiah. He's the head. We're his body. Now, I just want to wrap it up with Romans, the 8th chapter, pick it up 1-4, please. Mm-hmm.
Romans 8, 1. Now, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Yahshua Messiah, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Yahshua Messiah has made me free from the law of sin and death.
So that's liberated. The Apostle Paul, being a Jew, from the law of what?
Sin and death.
Sin and death. That's what was under the old covenant. So it's liberated him. It's made him free from that law. Go ahead and read 3 and 4, please.
For what the law could not do, that it was weak through the flesh, Yahweh sending his only son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit.
Okay. Drop down to 22 through 25.
22. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now.
The whole creation's travailing. Look at creation. Look at Mother Earth. How polluted it is. We've got the red tide down here now. It's I could go on, but don't let me. Go ahead.
23, and not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves grown within ourselves.
So what do we have? What do we have?
First fruits of the Spirit.
First fruits of the Spirit. That's taking us all the way back to Leviticus, the 23rd chapter.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, read.
Even we ourselves grown within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope.
So what are we waiting on? We have Yahshua's spirit in us.
Mm-hmm.
So we are a spiritual kingdom on earth.
Mm-hmm.
But we're waiting for this, for the universal revelation of Yahshua the Messiah, the consummation of the physical universe, and for our bodies to make that change.
Mm-hmm.
The Holy Spirit in you, that's going to change your physical body into a body like unto his, a glorious body. And that's what we're waiting for. 24 and 25, and I'll
24. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why does he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it.
That's what gives us patience. I hope this made some sense. I hope that people were edified by it. I'm going to turn it back to the moderator. I thank you for your attention. All praise and glory to the boss. Hallelujah.
Mm-hmm. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. White. For our last speaker, I'd like to introduce Dr. Sasha Rafinovich from Texas.
Good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me well?
Yes.
Thank you. It's a surprise, but I'm grateful to be a part of the Ithaca class today and to testify about the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. Well, Happy New Year, everybody. I really, New Year, it's a huge celebration in Soviet Union and in Russia, where I originally came from.
Yeah.
So, I don't want to go into this, but just to mention that our tradition, as I said, it's the greatest holiday of the year. And it's very similar to celebrating Christmas,
mm-hmm.
because we have a New Year tree, which is decorated very similarly to Christmas tree. And we have the person who is like a twin brother of Santa Claus. And in Russia, he is called Ded Moroz, which means Grandfather Frost. But he looks exactly like Santa Claus. The mm-hmm. difference probably that Santa Claus is riding a sleigh with the reindeers and Grandfather Frost riding a sleigh with three horses. Mm-hmm. But this is illustration that it's really, and I don't want to go there, but it's a really pagan tradition. And because we don't celebrate in Soviet Union, we didn't celebrate Christmas, but we had this New Year tree, very similar to Christmas tree. And I never asked myself where this tradition came from. Now, when religion is not banned in Russia, people do celebrate Christmas. And as you probably know, they celebrate the Christmas on the night from January 6th to January 7th. It's another witness that the true Savior or Messiah was not born on December 25th or January 6th. And we do celebrate his birthday, but not physically, but spiritually. And that's what the previous speakers were testifying to without really spelling it out, but we're celebrating this new birth of the Messiah or life within our soul every day of our life, giving praise to our Father through Yahshua the Messiah. So I really enjoy the testimonies of or lectures of the first two speakers. And what was on my mind, it's pretty much talk about, you know, the same thing, because everything is talking about the purpose of Yahweh, all Bible, all different stories, one way or another, it's talking about Yahshua, whose name means Yahweh is salvation. And what I would like to do is just to go to the very beginning of the purpose and to show you, some train of thought about how this purpose was established and how Yahshua, as it was already expressed by both speakers, came to fulfill what was written about him in allegory. So what I would like to go, to the beginning of Genesis. And please read Genesis 1 and 22.
Genesis 1 and 22. And Yahweh blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let fowl multiply in the earth."
Right. So Yahweh created Adam, and Eve was within Adam at this time, and he told them, be fruitful and multiply. So this is a purpose of Yahweh declared. That's what's going to happen in the end. But then he is giving them, after that, another commandment. Genesis 2, and please start reading from verse 15.
2 and 15. And Yahweh Elohim took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And Yahweh Elohim commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. And Yahweh Elohim.
No, that's good. Thank okay. you. Your voice was breaking up a little bit, but it's okay. So then Yahweh Elohim gives a commandment to man. So you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree of good and evil. Otherwise you should die. So we see it first comes the purpose, you know, it's to be fruitful and multiply, because it's all testifying about the purpose of our Creator, because all is pointing out, you know, to Yahshua, to Yahweh Elohim at this case, because his purpose is to be fruitful and multiply, you know, but then, you know, it has to be the law is given, and it's talking about death. So it has to, the Adam, it's already pretty much foretold in that, because Yahweh didn't say if you eat, you are going to surely die. He said when you eat of this fruit, your tree of good and evil, you will surely die. So it's, we'll know that, you know, the man will die. Mm-hmm. And, but there will be the way to escape, the way to salvation. And that's what we read just several verses after that, starting in Genesis 2:22.
Right. And the rib which Yahweh Elohim had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be woman, because she was taken out of man.
Continue on, please.
24, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And they were both naked, and the man and his wife, and were not ashamed.
Right. So he says, for this cause, the man will leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife. So it's a prophecy about what's going to happen with Adam.
Mm-hmm.
But Adam in the scripture, he is a type of he who is to come. This is Romans 5 and 14. So he is a type of Yahshua, the Messiah. So we know what happened with Adam. He was given this promise to be fruitful and multiply, but then he ate a fruit of knowledge from the tree of knowledge of good and evil.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, after his wife, you know, his wife Eve was deceived. You know, I'm just cutting the story short because I want to talk about something related to it, but not exactly this. But you know the story, how Eve was deceived, and Adam, out of love for his bride, he, I would say, take upon himself, you know, the sin of his wife, and he broke the commandment of Yahweh. And for this cause, as it was saying, you know, he left his father and mother, and his father and mother was Yahweh Elohim, because Yahweh Elohim created Adam, and he cleaved to his wife, to Eve. And then they start, you know, they were expelled from the garden, as we know, and they had children, and from the physical standpoint, mm-hmm. you know, they became fruitful and multiplied. Mm-hmm. Now, it all points out to Yahweh Elohim, whose name is Yahshua. As you can see on this chart, on the Moses chart, so you see the cloud, and we say in moderation that this cloud depicts Yahweh in his state of ontological perfection, on in his state of the pure spirit. But then he formulated the purpose, and the purpose was to be fruitful and multiply. So Yahweh Elohim created the heavens, the earth, and created animals, and he created man. But it was dictated by what we read in Genesis, that it's the state of death is going to happen, and in the spirit, you know, the change from the higher spiritual state to the lower spiritual state, as from the state of ontological perfection of your spirit in Yahweh to the state of Yahweh Elohim, which was in part and in totality, it was like a really much more restrictive state. And even more so, you know, the same spirit took on shape and form as Yahshua the Messiah and came to this earth plane, which is, again, the manifestation of death or limiting in the spirit, you know, of Yahweh in his omniscient and omnipotent abilities. But then it's dictated by the story with Adam and Eve, because it was a prophecy about Yahshua the Messiah, that he came to this earth plane to die for his bride, as Adam died for his bride. So here, being without sin, as Adam at that stage was without sin, because he was not in the transgression which Eve had. And what I mean, he was not deceived by Satan. So he became a sin for us, for his bride. He took upon himself the sin of the people, and he died on the cross, because it was stated in Genesis, you know, if you know that you will surely die, and Yahshua had to die to atone for the sin of Adam and to be united with his bride. And when he did so, he was separated from his father and the mother to cleave to his wife. And you remember on the cross, he said, Eli, Eli, or my El, why have you forsaken me? So it was the state of separation. But now I would like you to read in Genesis, third chapter, starting from the beginning.
Genesis 3:1. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which Yahweh Elohim had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, has Yahweh said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim has said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die.
Well, just I'm sorry for interrupting you. As Frank said, you know, I'm not trying to be rude. You know, I just want to make, you know, some points. So Yahweh Elohim told them, as we read in Genesis, second chapter, he said, you may freely eat of every fruit of every tree of the garden, right, except one. So it's a, you know, it's a declaration of grace. Really, look, everything is available. Everything is in abundance. But how Satan is tricking the woman, he's not mentioning this part. He is focusing on what they're not supposed to do. He's actually starting his question with a negative form. Did not, you know, Yahweh said, and, you know, woman who didn't have any ability to discern good and evil, so she was became prey to Satan. And then we read the story that she partook the fruit from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And then Adam did the same. Now, the question is, in the Bible, as we know, and we know Romans 1:19 and 20, I just don't have time to read it, but in Romans 1:19 and 20, it's talking about that, you know, the physical things explaining or revealing spiritual things. That's how Yahweh made his purpose. So what we read in the stories in the Bible, and in this story in the garden, which is very important because it's in the very beginning of the book, and it's kind of in a nutshell, it's telling the purpose of you know, of the creation, you know, to have to be fruitful and multiply in the end, and that's what's accomplished by as I said, and I guess I didn't continue, that Yahshua cleaving to his wife or to us, taking upon himself the sin of the assembly or the church or his chosen or the wife, it's all the same thing, and dying for her. But then it was already explained by the previous speaker. He gave his chosen or his wife this his Holy Spirit, and from the spiritual standpoint, we, or his chosen, or his bride, or spiritual Eve, was able to be fruitful and multiply and to bring forth the fruits of the Spirit. But, you know, going back, why Yahweh set up this here, specifically mentioned two trees in the garden. One, it was the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And this tree was associated with death, because you eat of it and you will surely die. And another tree was the tree of life. What do these trees symbolize? Now, if you think about it, that the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, what is the knowledge of good and evil? It's would be like a moral law. So you know what is good to do and what is bad to do, what you're not supposed to. So this tree of knowledge of good and evil is the type of this old covenant, which will be later given to children of Israel, or again, it's Eve, but in a different form, as Frank was saying, the first speaker. You know, Israel was the wife of Yahweh, the same way as Eve was the wife of Adam. And she was, you know, given this Mosaic law, or, you know, Adam and Eve partook of this law. And as a result, they died. And when they died, it says, in the day when you partake of it, you will surely die. So it happened in the day spiritually, so, or it will happen in their conscience, because in their conscience, the people became separated from their creator. Now, Greg, could you please show the first or second plate, depending on the chart you have, like elementary chart I'm looking for. I'm looking at the chart where Adam and Eve are cast out from the garden. Thank you. That's exactly what mm-hmm. I need. So you see in the this chart, or this first plate on this chart, is, as we know, it's broken down according to this tabernacle pattern. So the upper part is like most holy plate, and it shows, in principle, righteousness, peace, and joy, or the people are in the unity with their creator in the state, in the garden of Eden. But then, as we read, you know, the transgression took place, and they are being cast out from the garden. So, because they, their soul became condemned, and they became separated from their creator. Now, I don't have time to go there, but I'll just mention it as a, you know, food for thought. Because if you look in our makeup, a man's makeup, so men are the spirit, soul in the body, which also goes according to this tabernacle pattern. So what, and when the people are born and they are innocent, like Adam and Eve in the garden before the transgression were innocent. So like when people are born and they're like children, they are innocent and there is no separation between the spirit and the soul. But when, you know, the prince of this world or Satan, you know, is shaping us during our time on this earth before we know the truth, you know, we become separated from, you know, our soul. It becomes separated from the spirit. Spirit, through the conscience, is saying, you know, that's what's good, what's bad, what's right, what's wrong. But we are, you know, become prone to lie and to deception and to all different kind of things. And we feel, and everybody feels this separation from the higher self, so to speak. And it's described perfectly by Apostle Paul in chapter number 7, when he describes himself being divided in his soul from the law of Yahweh, which is in his spirit, under this old covenant. So, you know, this is, again, this is the type of them, the tree of knowledge of good and evil. It's like a law. So they sinned because sin is breaking the law. Now, in the third chapter of, let's go to Genesis chapter 3, continue, it's in chapter 3, and verse 24.
Genesis 3:24. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life.
Thank you. So what we see here is that Yahweh Elohim put a cherubim with a flaming sword. It's like a judgment for people's transgression. This cherubim or angel was put here to guard the way to the tree of life, because the sinful man, you know, should not partake of tree of life, otherwise he for the eternity would be sinful, and it's not the purpose of Yahweh. Right. Now, what does this angel represent? That's the question which I had. What's the angel with the sword represents? Now, Dr. Kinley explained to us, based on his vision and revelation, that this cherubim was a Michael. So it was Archangel Michael, and you can see it on this chart. It says it's Michael. Mm-hmm. Now, what does Michael represent? Now, if you, could you, Greg, please go to this tabernacle chart, or Badian tabernacle maybe, or any tabernacle chart.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, so in the most holy place, you can see two figures of archangels, which are Michael and Gabriel. And they represent two witnesses of Yahweh. And these two witnesses of Yahweh in the Bible are the law and the prophets.
Mm-hmm.
So Michael is the warrior. And when we read the book of the law, it's all these different events that's taking place, and Exodus, and it's a lot of action is going on. So Michael represents the law, and including the Mosaic law as well. And Gabriel, he's a messenger, and he's representing the prophets, because mm-hmm. prophets were relating the messages of Yahweh to the people. So going back, if you go back, Greg, please, to the garden picture. So this Michael with a sword in the garden, it represents the law. Let's read Romans 2 and 12.
Okay. Romans 2 and 12. Am I breaking up or am I okay?
You're fine.
Okay. For as many as have sinned without law shall also perish without law, and as many as have sinned in the law shall be judged by the law.
Right. So Adam and Eve, they were given the law, and they were sinned in the law because they, you know, they couldn't keep it, you know, what Yahweh prohibited them to do. And they're going to be judged by the law. So the Michael with the sword, and the sword is the weapon of judgment, is representing, you know, this law judging the people. And the people could not attain to this most holy place or back to unity with Yahweh Elohim because, you know, this Mosaic law won't allow them to do it. And we read it in a scripture reading, because the law, nobody was able to keep this law because it wasn't inside of these people to, you know, to keep this law. Nobody was found righteous. It was stipulated in the law that it would be people's righteousness, or they can be right in the Creator, or let's say they can go back to this most holy place if they keep these commandments. But nobody was able to keep the commandments. Now, this sword is represents the judgment. Now, it's interesting because, you know, Yahweh is arranging his purpose in a different way. And one way is end is determined from the beginning, as we know from the Isaiah. So when we read in Genesis 3rd chapter about this sword, this is the first time the sword is appears in the Bible. And it's important when this certain word appears the first time and the last time in the Bible. And let's see when the sword it appears the last time in the scriptures. And now by scriptures, I mean the Old Testament of the Bible. So the last mentioning of the sword in the Old Testament of the Bible. Please read Zechariah 13 and 7.
See Zechariah 13:7.
Mm-hmm.
Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, and against the man that is my fellow, saith Yahweh of hosts. smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered, and I will turn my hand upon the little ones.
Thank you. So this is a prophecy about Yahshua the Messiah. Remember, in Adam, you know, all died because Adam transgressed the law. He became condemned in his conscience, and it was a judgment upon him. And he was in a state of spiritual death. Now, Yahshua is coming on the scene when he was manifested in the physical body to atone for the sin of Adam. It was already mentioned in John 1:29. Behold, the Lamb of Yahweh, who takes upon himself the sin of the world. So he's taken upon himself this sword, because Yahshua is the shepherd in John 10th chapter. So he's taken upon himself the judgment and this punishment, because the punishment for the sin is death. So he's dying in place of Adam, or in place of his chosen, so we can have eternal life. And that's how it's manifested.
Luke 23:45.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was rent in the midst. And when Yahshua had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having thus said, he gave up the ghost.
Right. So what, you know, why I'm reading it, it's when Yahshua died during his death, burial, and resurrection, the veil in the temple, the veil between the holy place, most holy place, and the holy place was rain and twain. Now, if you look at this chart with Adam and Eve, this Michael, or this archangel with a sword, he was at the veil protecting them from the tree of life. And by his death, by taking the punishment upon himself, he's taken away this guardian angel. Let's prove it. 2 Chronicles 3:14. Now we are reading the description of this veil in the temple.
2 Chronicles 3:14. And he made the veil of blue and purple and crimson and fine linen and wrought cherubims thereon.
That's all I want. You see, it on the veils, there were, you know, pictures, you know, of figures of these cherubims. So by this veil, written in twain, it's symbolically shown that this angel, which was guarding the way to the most holy place, to Yahweh, is to Yahweh Elohim, to unity with him, is taken away. And now the access is available. Mm-hmm. And Apostle Paul, who had a revelation by the Holy Spirit, he is looking into the same thing. And he is writing about it in Hebrews 10th chapter.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go to Hebrews 10 and 19 and 20.
Hebrews 10:19. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Yahshua, by a new and living way, which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh.
Right. So the veil in the temple is likened to Yahshua's flesh. And right, when he died on the cross, this veil was taken away. And what does it mean? It means that now, thank you for showing this picture. Now we can look into, we can come boldly, it says, and we can see in the most holy place, which was hidden from the people before that. It was always darkness there. And only the high priest could go there on a day of atonement. High priest symbolizing Yahshua the Messiah. But now the most holy place, you know, we can look at most holy place, or we can understand the hidden or things of Yahweh, or to understand his spiritual principle or to understand his purpose. And in us, this veil, which is Yahshua in the flesh, has to be taken away, because as long as people think that, you know, Jesus, as they call him, or even Yahshua, he resurrected in a physical body, he's sitting as the physical man on the right hand of the Father, or will come pretty soon on the physical earth to rule for 1,000 years as a physical man, it means the veil is not taken away. It means these people are still condemned in this conscience. They don't, you know, they're not saved. They're not in unity in their creator. And I see I have a couple minutes left. And what's in the most holy place? It's a tree of life. And what does tree of life symbolize? It's a new covenant. It's the kingdom of Yahweh. Just a couple of verses about it. Proverbs 3:18-19.
Proverbs 3:18. She is a tree of life to them that lay hold upon her, and happy is everyone that retaineth her. Yahweh by wisdom has founded the earth. By understanding, he has established the heavens.
So it's talking about wisdom and understanding being the tree of life. And we know that eternal life, it's knowing and understand Yahweh and Yahshua. This is John chapter 17, verse 3. And because I'm out of time, the last verse, or couple of verses, Revelation chapter 22, verses, start reading from verse 1, please.
Revelations 22:1, and he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of Yahweh and of the Lamb. And in the midst of the street of it, on either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations.
Right. So, and Yahshua is the tree, and we are the branches, 12 branches. It's like 12 disciples, 12 tribes of Israel. It represents the bride, and we become fruitful. And Yahshua is multiplying us in his attributes, wisdom, intelligence, knowledge, love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, strength, and righteousness, peace, and joy, which makes it 12 attributes. So I hope it was edifying, and praise Yahweh through Yahshua the Messiah. Thank you.
Pam, are you there?
Pam.
Okay, I'll read the doxology. Thank you, everyone.
Oh.
Are you there, Pam?
Yeah, I'm here. I'm here. Sorry. It now concludes our today's lecture. I've been reading the doxology in the last two verses of Jude, as it is in the Holy White Bible. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, belong to Joshua and Messiah, our sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say in unity,
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.